So, welcome to Örgryte Church and the Nathium and Baroque organ, and our journey through the 17th century with some developments of repertoire and a selection of important composers for the organ, organists. And we start with the Organistenmacher in Amsterdam, Jan Pieterszoon Sweelinck. And we can sort of discover Sweelinck's organ in this concept. There was a close connection between the Dutch and the North German organ building traditions, particularly around 1600. And in Schnitger's concept, which we have here, we can still see and find most of the resources of the early 17th century and Dutch tradition. Although there's more differences, I think the similarities gives us an unusual opportunity to explore the soundscape. And we start with what we call today the free works, and three main categories: toccatas and music based on harmony with some kind of figures and diminutions and things. And that is a style that is quite new. We can see traces of it in the 16th century, called different things, ricercare or toccata or something. And one of the Sweelinck pieces, I would just show how you can experience it in sound with mean tone temperament. And we start with the Plenos Principal 16, octave 8. I skipped the Rauschpfeif with a quint 2 and 2/3 because that was not in Schnitger's concept in the same, in the Dutch concept of that time in the mixture design. So we don't enhance that. So we have 4 foot, 2 foot, and mixture. So chords and a little bit of change and pitch, and then after a little while it moves into diminutions. And the effect of this music with richness, fullness of harmony can also be experienced very well in the Rijkpositiv, which had the same resources in the Dutch organ concept, but more stop knobs and sliders. So it sounds like this. And bright and transparent, which is typical for the Dutch plano of this time. Now we have also the polyphonic pieces. Fantasia is like the famous chromatic fantasia or the hexachord fantasia. And there, of course, we need clarity for the polyphony. And that's where we are quite convinced that the general European practice of using fewer stops, maybe just the principal 8 or the principal with the octave 4, is a very good option. So we try the hexachord fantasia with the principal 8 and 4 of the Rijkpositiv. And the hexachord fantasia is built on the hexachord. As a counter subject, which is what we hear first in this piece. Mm-hmm. So we heard two presentations of the first theme, and then the hexachord appeared in the bass. Svelvik's playful virginalist kind of figuration in the first presentation of these themes. And he continues to explore in varieties ways of combining these themes. And the registration is basically like this all the way through. However, in the pedal, Svelvik had a trumpet 8. And sometimes it's nice to be able, when the theme, the hexachord appears in the bass or in the tenor particularly, to bring it out. So this is a possibility to use, for example, in this place. So now I played it both in the manual with the principal and with the trumpet. So it was a colla parte. And that's something I enjoy doing, where it appears in different parts and ranges. Toward the end of this fantasia, we get more 60 notes and figurations. And there is three sections, often the case in his toccatas and fantasias. And of course, you could change and move, start maybe on the Rückpostief and go to the Hauptwerk when the 16-foot figuration starts, either with 8-foot pitch plano or 16-foot plano. So the third section starts in measure 137, and there you may want to add a little bit of plano pitch without repetition, so 2-foot. And then in measure 183, when the 16-note figuration is added, move maybe to the great with the same 8-foot pitch plano. Places like in measure 205 become more, I think, rich with this kind of registration. Polyphonic texture basically without the large sounds, but with a possibility as it gets more energetic, maybe in the form toward the end, to add something of that. And now to the third category of free works, which is very special and a new particular genre for Sveling, the echo fantasia. And here the dialogue echo is really the most important thing. And it has its origin in the 16th century repertoire, like the Venetian composers, the Gabrielli family. So here's a canzona. I just play the beginning so that you have an idea. Where you have the dialogue between two ensembles explored in with one instrument, and there you can play in different octaves, or you could have a dialogue between different divisions. And that's what Sveling explores in the Echo Fantasias. He often starts with a polyphonic section like the polyphonic fantasias, and there we could start just with a principal eight. And in the design of Sveling's organ, he had a Hauptwerk, he had a Repositiv, he had an Oberwerk. The Oberwerk wide scaled with flutes, with reeds, no real plano. And then the Hauptwerk and the Repositiv, like two similar divisions. The Hauptwerk only with the principal 16, octave 8, and with a mixture and a cymbal, and then in the Repositiv with more sliders and stops and possibilities of selections. So we take the principle of the Repositiv for the beginning, or of the Hauptwerk. And if we want to have this possibility to have dialogue with sound, maybe the natural way would be to use, for example, the trumpet sync solo of the Oberwerk. We can have a look at this here. So we see in the design the Oberwerk with a wide scaled flute, 4 2 2/3 and Gemshorn, Sifflute, the cymbal, and then the trumpet and the sink. And the sink was just in the treble, or actually starting on the same note like the instrument sink did on the tenor F. And we have similar sounds in the Repositiv, which has generally much narrower, elegant character. So in most traditions we would think that the Repositiv would be the main kind of solo and the echo coming from the Oberwerk. But here with this reed registration, we can see that probably this was the other way around when reed sounds were used. So we take the octave 8 for the beginning and for the accompaniment, and then we have the trumpet sync solo of the with the Gemshorn tube of the Oberwerk, and then in the Repositiv here we take the barb 5 with the 4-foot and 2-foot flutes. A motet, polyphonic beginning, that moves on and becomes a little bit more keyboardish, and moves to a different pitch level. course, it is an echo if I just play on a one manual organ, the way he's written it in octaves. But with the three manual design and organ that he had, this is a very natural choice. In the continuation, there might be places where you could use the echo with more figuration, like here. And so forth. So dialogue and echo. In the third section of the piece, we encounter more homophonic textures, more like a toccata, and there it is possible to move to the pleno, or maybe just an 8-4-2, or 16-8-4. I think 8-4-2 gives more clarity texture. So let's try that with the root positif and the great 8-4-2. Principles 8-4-2. And it changes meter. So here again we have dialogue repetitions. There's no indication of manual changes. There's no information about how to play these pieces. But using an organ of this kind, you can certainly explore the colors in a meaningful way this way. So the Echo Fantasias invite us to a selective performance. We have to look at the piece, the compositional techniques, the structure, and then think along with the tonal design of Zwilling's instrument. How could we render this and make the orchestration ourselves? So from these three main categories of free works, we move to the variation works. And today we used to divide them into sacred and secular. I think in Zwilling's time in Oudekerk in Amsterdam, where the organ was not allowed to play in liturgy, in the Calvinist Reformed Church, I think we could say it was probably more like cosmological, cosmic music, and human scale music. So, Allein Gott in der Höhe sei Ehr, a hymn that was never sung in Amsterdam. It's a Lutheran hymn. But maybe his students brought it, he knew of it, and here we have some beautiful variations. The first, just a chordal presentation. So maybe you could do this in the root positif with a pleno 8-4-2 scharf. Is a beautiful experience with mean tone temperament, pure major thirds, and you see Zwilling avoids the fifth in the chords towards the end, so we don't hear the chord with the fifth, we hear it without the fifth, and listen to the difference. The second variation is two-part, a bassinium, we could say. And here we could imagine you take away the mixture, that symbol, and then you just play on the door for the principal eight. The Rig Positiv is the main facade principle, because we had the 16 foot in the grate. So when we want to hear delicate sounds that can be really audible in all ranges, use not the 8 foot of the Hauptwerk, but the 8 foot of the Rig Positiv. The third variation has three parts, and the melody appears in the tenor. So maybe one could play it with a trumpet, bring it out. There were two pedal stops, a trumpet and a Nachthorn. But it has some ornamentation, so it doesn't work so well. But the possibility to play it with a reed stop that is louder in this range might be a good choice. So let's take the trumpet 8. Of the Oberwerk with the octave 4. And the last variation has again chordal texture with a little bit more of figuration. So why not the splendid great piano, 16 foot based. And let's go to another set of variations, more human scale, a dance, the Ballo of the Grand Duke. And here, let's move from the cosmic sounds, the big sounds, and the principal sounds to the flutes and to the reeds. So we could play with the Barb 5 and the Flute 4, maybe with the Trächterregal and the Flute 4. And just to explore sounds here, Sweling didn't have them, but the Vox Humana of the Oberwerk.
Thank you.
in the next variation, we could just take the 8-foot flutes. The beautiful schere geduct of the repositive, the 1630s whole flute 8 of Fritzsche in the Oberwerk, and then the Rohr flute of the Oberwerk to change, and the Schnittke Spitzflute 8 in the Hauptwerk. And now the 4-foot flutes, the Blockflute 4 of the Rückpositiv Scherer style, and the Schnittker whole flute of the Brustwerk, and the wide-scaled Langswehling's big 4-foot flute, Spitzflute in the Oberwerk. The next one moves a lot in the treble, so we could explore flutes 8-4-2 or 8-2. And we take the geduct and the querflute, the traverso flute of the repositive, with its distinct speech and character. And then, like in Zwilling's organ, the wide-scaled Gemshorn with a whole flute, and then we have the Waldflute with the Holz principle in the Brustwerk. Thank you. The last variation has more of a sound richness effect, so maybe a little bigger sound, like 8-4 principles or 8-4-2. So we take that in all divisions, 8-4-2. We have a little overview of the Svelink Schrongers of composition for keyboard organ, and when we went into this human scale repertoire, we have lots of the virginalist figuration and influences from that point. So very interesting things. He develops with a keyboard idiomatic style, blending the new elements of his time, keyboard toccata, with lots of figurations. He continues the polyphonic style and develops this with the richness of figuration and compositional techniques. He has this new mixed genre with Echo Fantasia, where we certainly can explore lots of possibilities with dialogue and echoes of sound. And then we have a lot of wonderful music, both of cosmic scale with hymns, variations, and then the human scale, and as we say today, secular variations.